Well, hello to everybody out there. How the heck are you doing? Welcome, of course, back to Rule of Two Review. And today, we're going to talk about something that I normally kind of really wouldn't talk about on Rule of Two Review. It's kind of a change of pace, and more so recently than anything, because honestly, lately, all I've been talking about, for the most part, is the Nintendo Switch. It's almost anyone on the internet is talking about right now, and for good reason. It's super damn exciting. I can't wait to get it. You can't wait to get it. Everyone can't wait to play it. Breath of the Wild's coming. Obviously, the Nintendo Switch is the thing to talk about for very good reason, and sadly, I haven't had much of a reason to even talk about much Sony or Microsoft stuff, even though I do like doing it. It's been all Nintendo, baby, and it's actually been really, really great. That being said, there is a pretty important topic and piece of news that came out today that, for some reason, just struck a chord in me in a way that made me realize I really wanted to make a video about this, address the topic, and kind of give some of the insight that I think may lead to what's actually happening. And what we're talking about is everyone's favorite company, GameStop. Now, you may or may not already know what piece of news I'm going to talk about, and it should be noted, I want to give this one caveat before I get too deep into this and kind of discussing my thoughts on what's going on here. I'm not really making a video to, like, completely expose GameStop or, like, totally disparage them. I'm not really in the business of doing that kind of thing. I don't really like talking shit unless there's really, really a good reason. And arguably, there is almost a good reason to sort of do that with what's going on, but because of the angle that I want to take with this conversation, I just wanted to point out that that's not really what I'm trying to do. I want to have just a more elegant, nuanced conversation about what's potentially going on, and my feelings about what might be driving GameStop to be doing what they're doing, as bad and terrible as it is, because I am going to talk about why it's really terrible. I just want you to know, I'm just not that kind of guy. I'm not here to throw people under the bus and just, like, really start shit, you know, about this whole thing. Everyone has talked bad about GameStop, and I can't really do that for a couple of reasons. One, I used to work for GameStop, and I loved my time working for the company. And two, because everyone does that. It's just too easy to be like, oh, GameStop's terrible, and it's like, you know, they're just a video game retailer. I buy a lot of games from GameStop. I have a great time shopping there. I have no other reason to just, like, throw them under the bus in any other specific way. I really just want to, like I said, have a very specific and open-ended, nuanced conversation about what I personally think is going on here. So, what is it that I'm even really talking about? Well, a brand new program within GameStop apparently has been rolled out and is going to continue to roll out over the course of this next year for employees, and it revolves around sales. And through specific sales goals and a sale culture it seems like they might be trying to make currently, there could be a lot of potential, and apparently already has been potential, for GameStop employees to go out of their way to do the wrong thing for the customer, sell the wrong game, lie about what might be in stock, or try to get a more expensive used game purchase out of people. And it's a pretty scummy thing to do, there is no doubt, even though I gave that nice little kind of preface and little speech about how I'm not trying to throw them under the bus and totally start crap with GameStop and be one of those guys, I still have to admit, absolutely, that what's going on here is pretty shitty and I don't think it's okay. However, I want to go into why I think it's happening once I sort of explain and give the details over what it is that is actually happening. So in the interest of full disclosure, I first read about this from a Kotaku article. I did see this on my Facebook feed. I thought it was interesting, so I went ahead and read the article before I started to form my opinions and really understand what was going on. And so I'm going to read a quick little excerpt that Kotaku wrote in their article. So full disclosure, full credit to Kotaku with what I'm about to read. It comes from their article. So GameStop is rolling out a brand new program called The Circle of Life, which is a completely terrible name. It's in quotations in the article. I don't know if that means that that's what employees are just dubbing it, or if GameStop is literally branding it as such to their employees within their store. So I don't actually know that. That being said, it's being called, quote unquote, The Circle of Life, and it has to do with what kind of goals GameStop wants out of their employees to achieve. Now, before I get into the whole thing, I need to say, like I alluded to in the beginning of the video, I worked for GameStop during almost the entire sixth generation. I was hired for them right before my birthday in 2002, which was, you know, a year after the GameCube and Xbox had launched. Actually, less than a year. This was probably 6 months after the GameCube and Xbox had launched, and then a year or so after the PS2. And I worked until 2005, just like a month or two before the 360 launched. I even had started taking pre-orders for the 360 by the time that I left. So I worked throughout that whole period, and I gotta say, it was a very different time for GameStop in that era, and it was also a very, extremely different time in the gaming industry. We have to remember that. I mean, the online culture and gaming had barely even started to get going. Nintendo wasn't doing shit diddly with online at the time. So you just have to kind of remember that when I say how much I really loved my time with the company. I got to work in the video game industry, I felt. GameStop helped get me to E3 in 2004, and I got to be one of the first people to ever play the DS, which was really fantastic. I don't know, I just really loved that time, and at the time, I loved the company. Since then, I of course shop at GameStop quite a bit, you know, less so now with online stuff, and that is actually going to be important further on into the video and the conversation, but I still love GameStop for what they are. I have to say that. And I do remember with my time at GameStop how much sales were certainly a part of the culture at that time. Reserving games, getting customers to reserve upcoming titles, which is now a huge business, and at the time it was kind of a newer thing thanks to companies like GameStop. And of course, what was at the time just called the Game Informer card. And it's gone through a couple of names and iterations since. I think the Edge card and the Pro Member card or whatever Rewards Plus it is now. I mean, I have one, I don't remember what it's called. But at the time it was the Game Informer card because you got your Game Informer subscription. And those two things were like the metrics that GameStop really wanted its employees to pay attention to, and we tracked success and quality employees based on how many reservations and Game Informer subscriptions you were getting from people a day. And it was like, it was a fairly light sales culture. It wasn't too aggressive, but it was present. We cared about it. I cared about it. It got me two promotions throughout my time working with the company, up to a manager. One of the main reasons, because I was actually very good at that. I'm actually good at sales, and I have a sales history, which will also come into play when I get into this. So anyway, I'm making this part a little long. Let me get to what's actually going on. So GameStop for a long time has been pushing certain elements of sales, reservations, subscriptions, all these different things, and now they're doing this Circle of Life program, and I'm going to now finally read to you what Kotaku wrote, summing up what this Circle of Life program is actually supposed to be. The program, called Circle of Life, gives each GameStop store different percentage quotas for 1, pre-orders, 2, reward card subscriptions, 3, used game sales, and 4, game trade-ins. Each of these quotas is based on the store's total transactions. Pre-orders and reward card subscriptions are based on the number of transactions, while used game sales and trade-ins are based on the total dollar value of transactions. If a store's quota for used game sales is 30%, and the store sells $1,000 worth of merchandise, GameStop expects at least $300 of that merchandise to be pre-owned. So initially, that might sound like a bunch of jargon and mumbo-jumbo, but it actually is really, really telling with what's going on. I just told you how back in the early 2000s, GameStop only cared, at least for what it wanted out of its employees, what it expected from its employees. It wanted reservations for games and Game Informer subscriptions. That's what they asked us to do. And here, there's two new things. Pre-orders and reward card subscriptions are listed. Used game sales and game trade-ins are now part of what's tracked and associated with an employee's performance. Now, they always cared about used games, obviously. The used game market is like the bread and butter of GameStop and EB Games, which is, you know, they've now since merged. And a lot of other mom-and-pop kind of stores, like the used games culture, does have value and merit, and these companies realize they make more money off of used games than they do with brand new games, and that's why. So they're obviously changing a lot of what it used to be, where they're adding the, you know, game sales and game used game sales and game trade-ins to an employee's performance, which is crazy, and the subscriptions and everything. And of course, you know, they're looking for a specific percentage of the store's daily sales to be used games. Now, through this, Kotaku has talked to a couple of anonymous people, and they reference this in the article, people who are saying, well, because of this, we sometimes are trying to get certain kinds of products into players' hands, and sometimes the more expensive version, because if, let's say, a brand new copy of a game is actually on sale, but the used copy is still a little bit more money, we're either supposed to only sell them the used, tell them that we don't have the new copy, or just try to get them out the door without spending any money, because we don't want them to buy the cheaper version. We'd rather them buy the used products, because, as this Circle of Life program is now telling us, GameStop is actually tracking an employees' sales of used product. And this is a problem. Long story short, now several minutes into this video, this is a huge problem because this is the kind of sales culture that squeezes the employee into feeling like if you want to be successful and maybe even not fired, something else that's referenced here, some employees being threatened with termination for not performing within these sales goals, this is basically squeezing employees into saying, we want you to sell these things and do these things only. And through that, people will, you know, regular everyday employees in a company like this are going to feel pressured to make really bad moral decisions, such as lie. The example used here is, if Watch Dogs new is on sale for $30, but we have it used for $55, we're going to lie and say, we don't have the new copy, we only have this used copy. So either that person is going to spend $55, more money, $25 more on a used copy of a game, or spend nothing and walk out the door without spending any money, and that GameStop employee is going to be seen as having done something better because that person didn't buy the newer copy for only $30, where you or I going in to shop at GameStop and buy a game, we'd much rather spend $30 for the same game as opposed to $55 for a used copy. We want to save that money. We're gamers and consumers, and we care about our dollar, and this program is starting to potentially influence GameStop employees to do really shitty things to its consumers. So now we need to get into what's really going on here, and I want to discuss with you guys what I think is really happening and why this has happened. Obviously, this is a problem. There is no doubt that this is a really, really bad business practice, and this is something that is screwing the likes of yourself and myself and people that we know who might go into GameStop to shop. It's screwing us over. And that's not okay, and it's the kind of thing that's really bad press. And yes, you can say bad press is good press, but in this situation, I don't really think that it is. So what's really going on here? Why is this happening, and why is this a bad thing? So to me, everything I see here, when I first read this, and I saw what the Circle of Life program is, and I read the examples that they have here in this article, and of course I'm going to have it linked below, so please go read it if you haven't. You need to hear what these anonymous GameStop folks actually have to say in terms of the stories they're telling of in-store life and what they've experienced through this program. So when I first read this, the reason I wanted to talk about it is because instantly I knew what was happening. I knew why a company as prevalent in the gaming industry, known as a gaming retailer like GameStop, would make such a boneheaded, shitty, evil decision that is screwing over its employees by making its employees screw over the consumer. And it's because the video game industry is a-changing, and in a lot of ways, for the worse. And I think that that's part of what's been doing this. The gaming industry is becoming so greedy and so focused on the dollar and so focused on the new purchase and so focused on the upsell and so focused on the sale after the fact. Just the gaming industry. And I'm not talking about the retail industry. Keep in mind, the gaming industry is different than the retail industry. The gaming industry are the Nintendos and Microsofts and EAs of the world. The retail industry is the GameStops and EBs and Best Buys and Targets of the world. So they're very, very different. But the gaming industry itself, when we look at these guys, Nintendo, Microsoft, and EA and all those guys, they're creating a culture where they're expecting more money to be spent out of its gamer. And that comes with DLC practices, really shitty unfinished games, sequels that we really don't need, microtransactions, mobile content, you know, ads in games. All of this stuff has really been changing the culture over the last decade, I would say. And beyond that, we also have the digital market. And that's something that I can't necessarily say is a bad thing, other than personally, for me, it's a bad thing because I don't care for it. I don't like downloading games. I don't like having files on my computers and on my consoles and stuff. I'm not a big fan of it, but a lot of people are, and it's a very fair way to offer people to buy their games. So I have no problem with it actually existing as a market. That being said, the increasing trend of that digital market, whether it's DLC or just complete digital copies of games, is really changing how us, the consumer, buy and consume our video games. And through that, the pressure has been being put on all of the physical retailers, all these brick and mortar stores, of which in the gaming industry, GameStop admittedly is king. Love them or hate them, they are the king of that industry. And this pressure is being put on them, you guys. And absolutely, it's one of the many things influencing them to change how they're going to get their money back. Through the advent of the digital market for video games, a lot of things are changing on the retail side. The simple fact that less and less people are going into stores to buy games, whether they're new or used, there are less people who are going into an actual store, opening a door, walking up to a person saying, I'd like to purchase this game. There are less of us doing that now. So in and of itself, just right off the bat, there is less revenue going into brick and mortar stores. I think that sucks. Because I get, it's like the circle of commerce. You want to talk about the circle of life, the circle of commerce means a lot of us have to do that. That's just basic economics, man. Economics 101 is that has to happen. And through this whole change in culture, there's less of that happening. So I totally understand that. The other thing it does is it absolutely strangles the very idea of the used games market. And as I discussed, and as a lot of you guys obviously already know, the used game market is huge and very important to businesses like GameStop. It is, like I said earlier, the bread and butter of a company like GameStop. I honestly think a lot of this is why GameStop over the last couple of years has also tried to get into like the retro market. We've all known about that, selling, you know, Game Boy stuff, Virtual Boy stuff, Sega CD, Genesis, Super Nintendo, this random old stuff, which is cool. Like, they're doing that because they're trying to find extra revenue. They're trying to find out how they can make up a lot of these funds that they're continually losing with more and more people buying games digital, which means less and less people trading in games, which means less and less people buying used games. That is the circle of life that's actually in jeopardy for GameStop. It's not this get game card subscriptions and sell used games and sell this and that. It's that circle they need. People buy games, people trade in games, people buy used games, GameStop makes money. That's the circle of life that GameStop and a lot of other companies admittedly have always relied on. So that's starting to go away with this whole digital market and everything that these companies over here on the industry side are doing. Again, a lot of it's not bad, but a lot of it is also bad. The other thing, and something that I'm guilty of partaking in, is online purchases thanks to benefits and deals, and not even just online. For me, Amazon Prime is an amazing deal when it comes to purchasing video games that has absolutely changed the way I purchase my games. And I've had to do that even though I do like going into stores and going to midnight releases and buying my games physical, or at least physical in a store, I should say. It has changed the way I buy my games because of the deal. If you are an Amazon Prime member, for the first 2 weeks of a game's release, you will get 20% off of that game's brand new price, which is incredible. And that includes the Prime shipping, which is free shipping. And in terms of game releases, nine and a half times out of 10 since I've been doing it, I'm getting my games on release day. It's at the end of the day usually, but I'm also typically working anyway. So I come home from work after a long day at the office, and there we go. I got my game waiting at my front door in my mailbox. Maybe my girlfriend got home before me and she brought it inside. I've got my games on release day, and I saved, you know, $8, $10, $15 depending on whatever it is I'm buying. That's an amazing deal. Now, Terminator Juice, who I do the podcast with every Monday, has recently talked about Best Buy's Gamer Club thing where they have something similar that seems like a better deal. I'm very curious and interested in it, and to be fair, that is a brick and mortar solution to getting people in these stores and a solution to people buying less used games and less stuff in the store. And that is pretty cool, and I'm going to check it out. But still, this Amazon Prime membership is, and I bring it up because Amazon is huge. It's not like I'm one of a very small amount of people using Amazon and Amazon Prime to buy stuff. Millions of people use Amazon Prime. And so just that one entity alone has, I guaranteed, made a humongous impact on GameStop's ability to make money. So anyway, in trying to wrap this up and filter this back down to the main conversation, what I think is happening is pretty obvious. The changing industry, and when I say changing, I mean in a lot of ways for the worse, some ways not. You know, so no one try to freaking crucify me here if you don't agree with that part. But for me, in a lot of ways, it's worsening. All the crappy DLC and microtransaction stuff, get out of here, man. So all of that stuff, the digital market, it's changing the way people buy and play and consume their games. And through that, a store like GameStop is seeing the squeeze, they're feeling the pinch. And this program and the squeeze and pinch that it's now putting on its employees is really just a trickle-down effect, man. It's just the result of GameStop saying, oh man, this is becoming more and more of a problem. Year after year, we're losing this percentage of money, and eventually it's going to get so bad we might have to close. How do we fix this? Well, we need to incentivize and pressure our employees to sell what we know makes us money. And it's not the brand new copy of Watch Dogs 2, because they make almost shit freaking diddly on that brand new copy, but the used copy of Watch Dogs 2 for $55, they make a lot of money. They make like $20-$25 on just one copy of the game at that price. And even if it's less than $55, they're making a really strong percentage. And to be fair, they have a right to do that. I want GameStop, I want any company to be able to be successful in the right ways that has integrity. I want them to be able to be profitable, to make money, continue their business, and hopefully not screw people over. So they have a right to have a used market and sell games for a price that helps them make a certain percentage of profit. I think that that's totally okay. However, this result is something that is just simply not okay. They're feeling the squeeze, and they're creating a really dangerous sales culture. Now, if we remember, again, I'm somebody who comes from a very long sales background in a couple of different industries. One of them is my current industry that I don't want to talk about, but I worked like in a music store doing sales. Blockbuster had sales goals, GameStop had sales goals, stuff like that. And I get it. I've been in the sales culture and I've been in positions where I have certain metrics and numbers that I've had to hit in order to perform and to do well. And luckily, I've always been very good at it because I'm just a people person and people like me, man. People just, they like Rob. If you meet Rob in person, you talk to me in person, you like me. It's just, it's a skill I have and I feel very fortunate. I'm very, very lucky. I have great people in my life because of that. But it's kind of my inside insight into the sales culture and the sales world. In the employment world, I should say, that helps me really understand what it's probably like at GameStop right now and what this is doing. And there was a recent example in the news last year. We all know a very large American company was in the news for creating that what they called pressure cooker scenario, where that pressure cooker scenario of such stringent sales goals created a lot of unfortunate, bad, fraudulent counterfeit activity within a very important industry and business, and I'm sure hopefully a lot of you guys know what I'm talking about, and that created such a stink, and I mean, the United States court had to get involved here. It was a big deal. We had senators and representatives and politicians abroad just grilling these folks about what they did wrong and how unjust and unfair it was to pressure people into making these really horrible moral decisions. And this is just the smaller scale, geeky video game version of the same scenario, I think. That, again, in no way, shape, or form would ever equal the measure of what that whole scenario was. But to be fair, it absolutely is the same situation. And so GameStop, I think, is making the wrong decisions to try to keep themselves relevant because the gaming industry is starting to say, we don't care about the brick and mortar stuff. We don't care what deals you get. We're providing all these ways for gamers to get stuff without you, whether it's online in Amazon or whether it's downloading from everyone's individual stores. That's how people are starting to buy more and more stuff. And it is dangerous for the retail business. And I do not want the retail business to go away. Absolutely not. I want GameStop to find a way, and other companies like GameStop, to fight and find a way to keep themselves relevant and profitable and keep doing what they're doing. But not like this, man. This is not okay. And you have to remember, again, as somebody who's worked in such stringent sales goal kind of environments, not only is this not okay or unfair to us, the consumer, it's really shitty and unfair to the employees, you guys. That's the other thing. The other element of this that my heart goes out to is those employees at this company that should just be about having fun and selling video games. And they're going through some real unfun times, I guarantee you guys. It's just, I get it in context of working at GameStop and in context of working at other sales-oriented jobs and businesses that I've done in the past. It ain't fun. It is not fun to do this, and a lot of these people are probably good people who know I shouldn't really convince this person to spend $20 more on a used copy. I should really help them get the better deal, because if I was that person, I'd want the better deal, but they're afraid of losing their job or getting written up or being looked at as a bad employee and all these different things. So it's a huge problem, and it's the gaming industry's change that I think is influencing GameStop to do such an unfortunate thing. So we can only hope that GameStop pulls its head out of its ass. They did contact Kotaku and give a statement that I did not agree with. Let me see here if I can find. There was a quote. I don't want to sit here and just look through a darn article with you guys watching me here try to figure it out. But they did reach out to GameStop and they said something how, you know, they believe that they're trying to create a good value for their customers and they're going to continue to work and kind of refine this system to make it something that makes sense. And it was kind of like a damage control kind of backpedaling sort of thing. And I understand why they said that. I just didn't buy it. But I hope I almost said Nintendo. I talk about Nintendo too much. I hope that GameStop does learn from what's going on here. And it's good that it's been brought into the public light. And the fact that GameStop even responded to Kotaku about it is, in fact, a good sign. So, that being said, I'm going to end this very, very long video about what I think is a very important topic. I really hope that a lot of you guys out there check this video and you hear what I have to say and you consider what's going on and hopefully watch this mostly to the end. I hope a lot of you guys watch this far, more so with this video than my other videos, because I think this one is important in a different way than talking about how much the Switch is going to be amazing. You know, I think that this is a more important kind of video. So, what do you guys think about this? What do you think about GameStop and this Circle of Life sales thing? What do you think about the industry and the digital age potentially influencing a company like GameStop to make these really unfortunate decisions? Does this seem as bad and nefarious as I kind of laid it out to be? Do you think it's not a big deal? A lot of different angles, as per usual, to come at this from, and I really want to hear you guys talk about this, because I know everyone hates GameStop, man, and, like, I get it, but try not to be, like, so negative towards them and look at this from a more objective and impartial viewpoint and see if that kind of helps a little bit, because this is not okay, and in no way was this about giving them a pass. That's why I called them out in this, but I do understand what's happening, and I just hope that the industry and GameStop and other companies like them can come together to find a better solution than this circle of bullshit that they've created here. So that's what I think, and that's what's going on here, guys. Thank you, of course, so much for tuning in. I really hope you enjoyed this video and this conversation, and I hope that you got something out of it. So tell me what you think about this whole mess below. Thanks, of course, as always, for tuning in, guys. This is Rob of Rule of Two Review, and I will catch you guys next time on another video.